Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Town of Scituate's Board of Selectmen's meeting. It is 7 o'clock. I'd like to call this meeting to order. And also, I'll let you know that this is being recorded on television. I understand WATD is here, too, so they're recording. Is there anybody else recording? Fair enough. Then let's move on to our agenda and ask for an acceptance of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Norton. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Looking at agenda item number 2, the walk-in period. Is there anybody walking in other than Mr. Vignani? Come on up, Tony. Perfect timing. Okay. Yes, if you would please come up to the microphone, please. Now, if you could identify yourself and your address. Yes, it is.
Okay, many of you know who I am. My name is Kathleen Joyce. I live on Oceanfront Street in Hamrock, Mass. And I'm here about a situation that I've been trying to resolve for 8 months with no avail. Last New Year's Eve, my husband became critically ill, experienced a serious heart attack. I called 911. The Scituate ambulances were out at other calls. It was patched through to Marshfield, whose ambulances were out at other calls. It was finally patched to another town, okay, who provided a backup ambulance. In the meantime, the Scituate Fire Department first responder truck did attempt to traverse our road to get to my house. The road was in deplorable condition. The town had discontinued all of our services. They no longer maintained the road as far as filling potholes. We hadn't been plowed. It had gotten extremely cold. We had a sheet of ice. It had never been salted or sanded. The conditions were deplorable. The fire truck, I thought, would never get to my house because they thought they were going to tip right over the riverbank into the river. It was even worse accessing the ambulance, and especially since it was a backup ambulance and we had lost precious minutes already because it had to go through 3 patch calls in order to respond. I could see the ambulance in the distance, and I'm saying, my God, you got to get here. You've got to get here. He's critically ill. I don't know whether you've ever had anybody that's been critically ill in your house, especially in the event of a cardiac problem, okay, but every precious minute counts, okay? It can mean the difference between life and death. The ambulance finally got to the house. The first thing these out-of-town paramedics said to me was, you have to do something about that road. We can't access or put our equipment in jeopardy like we just had to do in order to access a house. And I said, well, we've been trying to find out why they've discontinued our services to no avail. I've been to the town hall several times. I've gotten no responses. So anyway, after my husband was stabilized and in the hospital, had a triple bypass and complications and whatever, I decided to take it upon myself to go to the town hall. I made several attempts to meet with the DPW director, the town administrator, got no calls back, okay. Finally, I went up and parked myself in the DPW office, and I asked the secretary to please have Mr. Bankert call me back at his earliest convenience, and I would be back every day until somebody called me, which I did. Finally, Mr. Bankert called me back, wanted to know how we could resolve this problem. I've had numerous meetings with him. I even arranged to have a residence meeting at my own home, invited him to come and address the concerns, and to ask what has happened. For 62 years, the town has maintained this road, plowed it, maintained the potholes, filled them in when they needed to be, provided police patrols, which were also discontinued.
I have to interrupt you because we have a limit on our walk-in for 5 minutes. So I guess I'm not trying to be discourteous, but what street is the street that you live on?
It's Old Mouth Road. It's River Street, which accesses into Old Mouth Road. We only have one street that it accesses.
Did Mr. Bankert meet with you and discuss?
Numerous
and did
times. Okay. He and keeps telling us it's a private
way. You gotta let me ask you questions, okay? Because that's my point, is the fact that the road is a private way and not a public road.
But it's used as a public access.
I understand that, but I'm just trying to get to
even
the.
Had
I'm trying
road
to get.
Races through
you got to let me finish my questions, okay? I'm just trying to get to the point which I think I'm at, which is, you live on a private way, and did Mr. Bankert say that because it's a private way that the town is not obligated to...
No, he said it was illegal, and we have yet to see this law.
Okay, all right.
If I may, sir?
Yeah, your name?
My name is Larry Tossi. I'm also a resident of Amarant.
Sure.
And actually, most of all of these people right here are all... Everybody raise your hand from that end?
Fair enough.
These are all people, as you can see, there's many elderly people here.
Sure.
What we would like to do, our concerns are this, obviously taking care of the roads, getting the police patrols back, whatever. We would like to, our goal tonight, we don't want to take up a whole bunch of time, but we do want to show you there is support here. We would like to see if we could have one of you people as a liaison with the rest of the board. Maybe we could meet, we could try to come to some type of an agreement on this. I think most everybody is bewildered, where they've been maintaining for 62 years and all of a sudden, and there was no notice of any kind at all. We found out when Mrs. Joyce complained. But anyway, I don't want to take up a lot of your time. We do want to show you that, you know, here, maybe we would like to see if we could have one of you folks as a liaison, and maybe we could set up something where we could come to some type of terms together and see if we can work this out.
Okay.
It's obviously, it's a terrible safety issue. And I mean, something like this could obviously raise all kinds of litigation if somebody couldn't get through, if somebody gets sick, blah, 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 whatever. I mean, the town would be inundated with all kinds of, you know, litigation as far as that goes. So we would like to, we came here tonight to see if we could work with you, and again, maybe appoint somebody to take care of us and see what we can do. That's where we're at, sir.
How does the board want, the reason why I'm kind of hemming and hawing is because there's a new, the recent law changed of the open meeting law, which is that we as a board cannot get into a discussion about an issue in a walk-in period. That's why I'm kind of having high, because we need to post it, okay? So when you see our agenda, it's posted, and so if we get into a discussion about this issue, we'd be in violation of the open meeting law, and then people will be, so that's why I'm kind of like sitting here going, how do we approach this issue?
Is it possible to go through
I'd be happy to do that, yeah,
that's
if
great.
We can schedule.
That would be fine.
That would be fine, that's all we're asking.
Agenda item, put it on the agenda, okay? So I'll tell you what we'll do.
Show them the pictures.
We'll put this on for an agenda. You know, I can't tell you it's going to be next week, but I would probably say at the meeting either after that or
the 21st.
Okay. So therefore, we can have a discussion about it. Okay. And I'd ask everybody to do that. Okay.
That would be fine, sir.
And John, in the interim, I think we can provide if. Folks want to put their address, we can provide information on their town's obligations and responsibilities or lack thereof for maintenance of private ways for which we are legally exposed to. So
we'll get something together.
There's a lot of statutory law and case law on it, so prior to the 21st, I'll try to put together a packet of information that explains why the town is actually doing the correct thing now and hasn't for 62 years.
Major concern is the fact that we have no other access roads. So if this becomes inaccessible, we can't get to or from our property unless we swim.
What we'll do is, like I say, I'll get to you, sir,
okay,
in just 1 minute, okay? We'll put it on for our agenda. I put it on next week, but the truth is we've got that full. So, and I'm not trying to say this is not an important issue. It is. We'll put it on the very next one after that. The gentleman in the back.
Road is probably 75 yards unpaved. And this is a section we're really worried about. And as far as I can see, the town has accepted that portion of the road.
I'll tell you, Mr. Joyce, I'm glad you're here, and I'm glad everything worked out for you. But I'd say, like I say, we'll discuss this, and I ask everybody to please put it on your calendars. 2 weeks? No, 3 weeks. 3 weeks, okay? And we'll go through that at that time, okay?
That's fine. Right. Thank you, sir.
That's
thank
fine.
You, folks. I appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Any other walk-ins? All right. If you want, I'll just, if people are staying, stay, by all means.
Those pictures, can you leave?
Sure. What's your name, sir?
I'll give you more than you probably need.
7 River Street, I'm not.
Okay.
Who owns the roads, the private ways? I asked Mr. Bangor that, and he said to me, I said, I don't own it. I can look at my deed. And he said he doesn't own it. He told me that the original developer owns it. 1914. That was the answer I got. Who owns the road?
But you.
Whoever owns the road is responsible for that road.
I'll tell you what, we'll
Can we discuss that at the meeting?
We can discuss it, yes. And I'd be happy to, okay? We'll go through there.
Will I give an answer?
The reason why I hem and haw here is because it gets into a situation where you got to look at the deeds. You got to figure out, and when they lay it out as to the plans and everything. So a short answer might be you do own the deed or own the road. You own to the middle of the road. And what I'm trying to say is that, you know, the answers could vary. But in this case, we'll talk about these issues in 3 weeks, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, folks. All right.
Thank you.
All right. I'm just going to let, as people walk out, I'll get to the next agenda item. I don't know if they're.
Terrific. What I'll do is I'll give you a big packet.
I thought I asked, but I'll ask again.
Because it will be.
Are there any other walk-ins? If so, could you please come up? Any other walk-ins? Okay. So we're going to move on to our next agenda item. Agenda item number 3. It's a discussion vote outdoor entertainment permit.
There's a lot more than meets the eye, and that's why the policy.
And
we want to make sure.
Folks, if you could please leave the selectman's room, please. Thank you.
All right.
Mrs. Joyce. I have to ask you folks, if you could have that conversation outside, I'd appreciate it.
So I'll write it down real quick, and then you can give me what you want.
No, I just want to put it on this side.
All right.
Okay.
The motion?
Yes. I'd like to move on to the discussion number 3, entertainment outdoor, an outdoor entertainment permit, Chessia for 234 First Parish.
Yes.
Chessia,
yes.
How are you? Okay. Tell you what, you're looking for an outdoor entertainment license? Thank you, Bob. For First Parish Road, Amplified Band Stereo Music on Saturday, September 4th, between 7 p.m. and 11 p.m., correct?
Okay.
Motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant an outdoor entertainment permit to Sue Cheshire, 234 First Parish Road, for Amplified Band and Stereo Music on Saturday, September 4th, 2010, from 7 p.m. to 11 p.m. Immediate neighbors must be notified of this event.
Okay. Any questions?
Just one quick question, and Sean just touched on it. It says the neighbors will be notified. Have they been notified?
Absolutely, yes.
Okay. What is the procedure for that? Should they come to us saying that they've already been notified?
I think it's usually either if they haven't been, that they have to be notified of it prior to. I think it's not necessarily that they have to notify them prior to coming to us.
But what if somebody has a concern? And they don't have the ability to come to us to. I'm just saying.
No, I see what you're saying. You're right.
Not your case at all. I'm just saying in the future, if someone's looking for it, they should have probably already notified so people can come with any. I mean, we've never had anyone come up and say anything, but.
How far do we have to go? Do we have to just ride around our surrounding neighborhood? Okay.
Yeah, they're all well aware, believe me.
Not this case. This has popped up. I've had this question for months.
I'm just going to tell you, when people make this application, I tell them that they must, by the time they come in, they will have to notify their immediate neighbors. I'm sorry if it's not worded that way, but I do make that pretty clear.
Okay.
So that's all squared away.
At this point, we're parking cars in most of our neighbors' lawns.
No, this isn't directed at you guys at all. This is really.
Just in general. The next ones that come up, mm-hmm. which is it's a good point. All right. Any other questions? Good. Motion?
Second.
So seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Good
Thank
luck
you.
On the wedding.
Great day.
Thank
Have
you
fun.
Very much.
All right. Moving on to agenda item number 4, discussion vote, amended traffic rules and regulations concerning Marshfield Ave in Humrock.
Good evening.
Good to see you, Officer Thompson.
Good to see you again.
And it looks as though that we're looking to provide longer parking hours on Marshfield for the business district on Marshfield Ave from 1 hour to 2 hours. Is that basic?
Okay. Correct. Yeah, this was brought to us by the some of the business people down there,
okay.
And it would really just be on the west side of the intersection. It's about 10 spots south side of Marshfield Ave, so it would be on your right-hand side as you go over the bridge.
Gotcha. Questions from the board?
So summer's still going to be 1 hour. In the sentence here, it says, two-hour parking in the town's business, except for 15-minute spaces for restaurants and 10 one-hour spaces.
Right, that's east of the intersection. So right in front of San Zen Cafe, there are two 15-minute spaces. And then the ones along the old Clam Haven, the Clam Shack there, those would remain 1 hour.
So you have 2 hour over here, one over here, and 15 here.
Right.
Motion?
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to amend the Town of Scituate's traffic schedules. Replace the one-hour parking on Marshfield Avenue East to the intersection of Central Ave with two-hour parking.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Unanimous. Thank you,
Mark. Very much. Have a good night.
Moving on to agenda item number 5, discussion vote of the MBTA Historic Trust Funds. And this is concerning the Cudworth House. Mr. Ball. And if you could just briefly explain, you're looking for a transfer of funds of about $3,000 from the MBTA Historical Resources Trust Fund. Specifically, you're looking to repair some vandalism that was done, I guess, to the stone wall. Also, you're looking to reframe and rebuild a side door entrance to the house, and that repair is about $1,400. Is that exactly? That's $2,000. And then what's the remaining $1,000 for? Is that just...
It's hard to predict at this point in time. We've had two repairs that have had to be done. One was to the animal pound that is on the property, and the other is repairs to one of the side entrance doors of the Cudworth House. That totals to $1,400. To avoid having to come back every time we have a minor repair, I put the request in for $3,000. And the reason for that is historical buildings budget for this year only covered utility costs. So the bottom line is right now we have two repairs totaling $1,400. There, I can envision a couple of other repairs that will probably have to take place this year. So instead of having to come back, I put it in for $3,000. The other comment that I did make is that if we can find some way of using a certain percent of the rental account from the man house, we could avoid having these requests, I think, for maybe a year and a half, 2 years. Right now, I don't have the latest figures, but I would say that right now there's conservatively $10,000 in the man house rental account. The only major repair that I can think of down there is to do some roof work on the barn, which would probably total, I'm guessing, $5,000. I've mentioned this before. I don't know if anything has been discussed about it, but I'm just throwing that idea out there.
Okay. Questions from the board?
Do you have access to the Manhill funds, or do we have to allocate those too?
When we have repairs at the man house, there's what's called a man house rental account. All the rent goes into that rental account. So if something comes up, we will arrange to have the work done. We then send a cover letter to the town administrator with the invoice. If it's a bigger item, they had to go out to bid, then that's done. But no, I don't have to come back to the Board of Selectmen every time we do something.
So do we have separate, like, you got the lighthouse,
you
I assume, rental account?
Lighthouse rental account. You have the man house rental account. When the Bates House is purchased by the town, there will be a Bates House rental account. But because we do not have a tenant, of course, at the Cudworth House, there's no income available at all.
The reason why I'm asking is, and Tricia, I'm looking at you. You weren't the one to create these, but why wouldn't we just put it all into one account for rent, you know, historical rental?
We can
rental?
Try and do that. My only concern is if, you know, we spend it generally and then the lighthouse needs something, and theoretically there's dedicated rental income for that. But I'll ask Mary, because that's what I was thinking, is it's just an all-in rental account instead of specific. The only problem is you say, well, there's no money to fix the lighthouse and it's generating, not, you know, 60% of the rent.
Right. I don't think that would be a wise move. I think it's still a good idea for accounting purposes to have it separate. I guess what I'm proposing is maybe a certain percent of the man house rent, even if it was $100 a month, if it went into the Cudworth, or made it available so that we wouldn't have to keep requesting funds for Cudworth. If we knew that, okay, 20% of the rent from Manhouse is going to be going to Cudworth, if so needed, that we could do it. I don't know that there's that mechanism in place right
Let's,
now.
I'll tell you what, why don't we find out from Mary, and then, you know, that's something we can discuss in the future then, Dave. All right. Other questions?
Motion.
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant the Historical Society's request for $3,000 from the Historic Resource Trust Fund for repairs of the Cudworth House.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ball.
See you, Dave.
All right. Moving on to our next discussion, agenda item rather, a discussion vote for a Hawker Peddler's license for the North Scituate Farmers Market. I think, are there three of them? Or just one? And looking for is Peter, is it?
Tarode.
Could you please come on up? Looks as though that you're looking for, obviously, a peddler's hawker's license. You do?
Somebody up front needs CPR? Yeah. Nope.
Call 911, Sheila.
Call 911.
Okay.
Want to run to the police station?
John, could you put this on hold, please? Our meeting on hold? All right.
Yep.
Just find out. And, okay. Tell you what, we're just going to take a 5-minute break, folks. If we can go back on again, thank you. Mr. Tirado, so you're selling exhibits, I guess, custom fishing. What exactly are you looking to sell?
I build custom fishing rods.
Got you. Say no more. Any questions from the board?
Cool. When is the season up? Isn't it up in September?
October.
October? Okay, so there's a couple months left.
But if I may, Mr. Chairman, maybe that it's coming to the last couple of months. And I think everyone will agree that maybe during the winter, because it's getting much larger and much more successful than any of us envisioned, I think. And I wonder if it wouldn't be a good, not now, but sometime in the fall or during the winter months, to have a meeting with the organizers of the farmers market just to put it all together and just see what we want to do going forward as far as rules and regs and limits or no limits or whatever. Would you see? Agree that that may not be a bad idea. Good idea.
We've actually registered formally with the state of Massachusetts, and we are now a 501c.
Okay.
And they have just wonderful guidelines that can define who sets up in the market. So we will be under their, we are now under their regulation. Operating on town property.
And that may be sufficient, you know, but maybe we should just all touch base somewhere.
Maybe what we should do is, because you finished in October, maybe at the end of October, beginning of November, if you could just remind us, and we'll put you on the agenda to have a discussion. And Kim, if you could just put in kind of that time period. Because we would, just to have some feedback, go through things, and then in preparation for next year, which would be great.
Thank you.
Now.
Motion.
Please.
Sure. Yep. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant the Hawker's Peddler's license to Peter Tarode, 4 Gannett Road, to sell custom fishing rods of the North Scituate town-owned commuter rail parking lot in front of the WPA building from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. on Wednesdays until October 31st, 2010. This license has a temporary waiver of the 15-minute rule, Selectman Policy Number 43-99.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, moving on to the next agenda item, discussion vote of emergency sewer tie-in at 119 Hadley Road. And on behalf of the Board of Health, Mr. Lynch.
Thanks.
Thank you.
This property is occupied, or not occupied, actually, because the owner has been in a nursing home for 4 years. The water's actually been turned off, so we don't have any pumping records, which we usually ask for in these types of situations. No documentation of any backups or overflows. But we do have, the engineer did 6 test pits on a, I think it's a 14,000 square foot lot, and there's no perk whatsoever. So the cesspool depth is also going to be in the groundwater during the high groundwater season, which is also a Title V violation. So this is a either a tight tank situation or a connection to the sewer. And the engineer has provided just a sketch of the sewer plan here. This is an area where, for whatever reason, before my time, the sewer line kind of, I won't say it's consistent, like a grid. And so the board in the past has, in these types of situations, granted some connections where houses were missed, and they obviously can't get a Title V system in. We did ask the representatives who were present in front of the Board of Health to consult with the Department of Public Works on this, but apparently, through a miscommunication, that has not happened yet. But Mr. Mirabito is here and is intending to present the plan to the Department of Public Works. But we're trying to encourage people to get that done before we come here to you. That's pretty much it.
Questions from the board?
I have the same question I asked last week. The cost of this is, what will the charge be to do this for the new owner?
You know, my memory is failing me again. We answered that. I forget whether it's $2,000 or $5,000 to connect.
$5,000.
I was going to say,
And how far is it, if I may, Mr. Chairman?
Yeah, oh, absolutely.
From the house to the sewer?
The sewer line in the street would be approximately 90 to 95 feet. There's a sewer manhole at the top of 11th Avenue. We would extend that line straight up the hill to the property line. There'd be an 8-inch pipe in a trench 2 feet wide with flowable fill and a laser patch, so there'd be no settlement. It's very straightforward. The sewers are typically down 7 feet, and that's what we do. Once we get to the property line, we just extend it to the house.
And there's no room for a Title V?
Absolutely not. I did the perks there. We were witnessed by the Board of Health. I did 6 test pits. The water only dropped about a quarter of an inch in 90 minutes. We found the old cesspool on site that was only down 4 feet. It's a very tight glacial till, which is compacted by the glaciers historically, and it just won't perk.
If you look at the soil logs, which we did give in there, that it's the same for each of the 6 test pits in the different areas in the property. This is a small lot. We usually don't have that many test pits on a 14,000 square foot lot.
Go ahead.
Mr. Harris?
I was at the Board of Health hearing when they discussed this. My only other question that wasn't answered then was, if this line is constructed, are there any, and Jennifer, I don't want to put you on the spot, but any other homes at the top of 11th, if they didn't have town sewer, could they tie into this line?
Well, my understanding is that usually this is a private line, and if they work out an agreement, I'm sure that there's, an 8-inch line would be adequate for the people.
8-inch would be plenty big enough. Usually a spaghetti line's 2 inches, isn't it, or something like that?
Sean, if I can add to that, what's unique about this is that as you look at the drawing to the bottom of the lot, there's a house on Marion Road, which is on sewer.
Uh-huh.
This is the Goldson property here.
Right.
These two houses are on sewer.
The reason we're bringing it straight up, and the reason that's an 8-inch line, if it was a spaghetti line, it would be 2 inches.
Right.
But this is a standard 8-inch sewer line, so it'd be built to the town specs. So if the town wanted to bring sewer down Hadley Road, they could connect to it.
Right.
But this pipe would never serve any other homes, because there's no homes around it that need to be sewered.
That was my question. The others around it already are tied in.
That's correct.
All right.
If I may. And this home will be lived in or torn down?
It'd be torn down. It's really not.
It's, the home now is about, what, 800 square feet?
Yeah, it's small. So it'll be torn down.
Yes, and we, the Board of Health, imposed a restriction that it would only be a one-bedroom. We always, when we grant an emergency sewer connection, at least for our purposes, restrict it to the existing bedroom configuration under Title V.
I don't think you can do that. Can you? I mean, if they tie into town sewer, though, I think then... Well, I'm saying, in other words, when they build, if somebody builds it, then they can expand it to 3 bedrooms or 4.
If
the door is open there.
If the sewer commissioners allow it, yeah.
Well, actually, it's a planning board issue, isn't it? A building permit issue? I mean, you're advising the building commissioner that a one-bedroom home is only going to be allowed to be constructed.
I don't know. If you're using a connection as a matter of right, as an emergency connection, I think that whatever authority is that grants you that permission can impose whatever conditions on it. You know, it's a deed restriction, I think.
Well, you mentioned it, cause I was under the impression that once the door's open, then you can expand it. So whether you call it a one-bedroom or not, they can still expand it, because it's sewer. But again, we'll find out, I guess. Yes, Mr. Norton.
Tricia, would you, this is just something I'm not sure, would you ask the Board of Health in conjunction with Jane Lopato, say the last half dozen emergency sewer ties in, all right, over the past couple of years. Could you check and see if those fees, that $5,000 fee has been paid?
This is only the third that we would have had in the last 3 years, and they've all been really this year because we didn't have any the previous 2 years.
Okay, so the last decade.
When does the fee get paid then? In other words, do they, before they break ground to connect to it, or do they connect and then, I'm asking you, Frank, but I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm just curious. I mean, because, you know, we really, when you think about it, they shouldn't be given the permit to dig unless they've paid. I would think.
Maybe they have. I mean, maybe this is just a moot question. I don't know.
No, well, we need the money, so.
I have a funny feeling, those funny feelings.
I would say that if you're going to grant the motion, that at least then they should, as a part of it, they should pay before they are granted the permit to dig, I would assume, at least.
I wouldn't think anyone would have a problem with that.
Huh?
I don't think anyone would have a problem.
They shouldn't.
I don't think so. So, any other questions? And questions from the audience? Seeing none. I'd entertain a motion.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to grant an emergency sewer tie-in for 119 Hadley Road.
Seconded
by Mr. Norton.
Are you going to add the payment contingency or no?
That I thought that was given.
That's a given.
Subject. All right.
Okay.
I
was going to say, just put in the motion, say
contingent upon
the payment of the
sewer tie-in fee of $5,000.
Second.
Great, as amended. All in favor? Aye.
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 Unanimous. Frank, it's always engaging here with you. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Moving on to the next agenda item. Let's go to number eight, 7:30. I'm sorry, we are past the time, and I apologize. We have a liquor license hearing. It's a transfer. Jamie's Pub, North Scituate. And my apologies. On behalf of the applicant, you are?
Ralph Constantine.
Mr. Constantine, it looks as though that you're looking to transfer the liquor license from... I'm looking at the Board of Health stuff here. Hold on. The present corporation.
Pebble Beach.
Pebble Beach to something different?
Jamie's of Scituate.
Jamie's Scituate, okay. What's the need? Why, what, what's...
Mr. Chairman, excuse me if I may, just my place of employment is involved financially in this transaction, so I'll abstain.
Okay. Could you just tell us what you're looking to do? Obviously, I know you're trying to transfer it. Why?
It's to make a long story short, I'll give you a brief synopsis. After my father passed away, there was a little disagreement between my father's wife and my sister and I, and so we had to went to probate court, where an administrator was appointed by the court. The administrator was responsible for facilitating a transaction to sell the rest, to liquidate the estate, as I'm sure you're familiar with what happens with probate. So we went and we were forced to list the property for sale, even though we did not want to establish a value. After a certain amount of time and only one offer, my sister and I made an offer to purchase it from the estate, of which we were 50% heirs of the estate, as is anyway. The judge in probate court accepted our offer to purchase the existing corporation from the estate, and so Sandy and I have now purchased it. And we actually do own, we did purchase the Pebble Beach Inc. name, so Sandy and I technically are owners of Pebble Beach Inc. It's would be considered a wholly owned subsidiary of Jamie's of Scituate Inc. So technically, I suppose we could keep the liquor license the way it is, but from the lawyers advised us to put the liquor license into the appropriate corporation.
Okay.
So it's really Sandy, who has been the manager of record for quite some time, is going to remain the remainder of record, the manager of record, and really nothing's going to change. It's more or less a legality just to change it from one to the other.
The agreement that you had, and again, I don't want to get into the minutiae of family squabble, but was that an entered as an order of the court? I see the agreement's here. It's signed by both of you, you and Sandra. But was that an
order? The judge granted, it's called a license to sell, and that license to sell was granted to the administrator, and at that point, we executed a purchase and sale agreement financed through Rockland Trust and purchased it from the estate. Funds were transferred to the other heir, and the transaction was finalized.
And the only reason why I'm asking is because I know we received, I don't have it here, correspondence from Attorney Leonard, who was in the room, I see. And my concern is that he raised an issue that there's obviously... there's a potential, shall we say, legal battle brewing. And my concern right now is I just want to make sure that we don't put the town in the middle of this. And,
well,
I'm saying I need to know if there's court orders. If there are court orders, that makes it a lot easier for us to...
Yeah, well, the administrator is here too, Mr. Albanese. And the issue, if anything, that Linda and Mr. Leonard would have would be with the estate, because that court, it would have been as if... you had bought the restaurant and purchased it from the estate. The court allowed it. The sale was legal. It's a done issue. Now, if he has an issue with that sale, it's with the estate. Otherwise, it was an order by the court allowing that sale.
Attorney Albanese, I'm sorry. I should have recognized you also. Do you have an order from the court, from the probate, or?
I was appointed.
Have a seat. That's fine.
I was appointed as temporary administrator and eventually as permanent administrator of the estate. Mr. Leonard's correspondence to the selectmen references a check that was issued, and that check was issued pursuant to the purchase and sale agreement. The purchase and sale agreement was submitted to the probate court for approval. And we had a lengthy hearing on it. This exact issue was addressed at that hearing. Clause of the purchase and sale agreement is standard in every commercial transaction. It essentially says that the purchaser of the property and the business doesn't buy the debt, that the seller has to settle all of the outstanding debt
accounts payable, either contemporaneous with the closing or at some time, we did it sometime thereafter. It was done after the closing and outside the closing, but it was well documented. And essentially what that check was that Mr. Leonard refers to was payment of all the debts of the previous owner. And that's standard in any transaction that I've ever been a part of. And at the hearing about this purchase and sale agreement, there was testimony given by the restaurant broker that this is standard practice. And the judge found in favor of the petition for the license to sell and issued the license to sell. So this was all done by approval of the court.
And the reason why I'm asking that is I think I'd feel more comfortable sitting up here if I have copies of knowing what the court. And Mr. Leonard, I'll get to you in a minute. So I think we have a purchase and sale. It's not signed by you.
It's just signed by the.
It's just signed by Ralph and Sandra. Mr. Leonard, did you? Oh, okay. Is that the? Yeah, no. If you would come up also. More than welcome. We aim to make friends.
License to sell. It was approved on March 31st, 2010.
Could I see that?
Can you see those?
Yeah.
Please. I'm sorry.
Thank you, Kevin.
Everything should be in here.
Yes. Thank you. Let's keep these. These are his. That's not confusing. Which one did he give you that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've had all this documentation before. It's part of my file. Kind of speaks for itself.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
I guess I'm confused. So this sum of $92,000 was a down payment, or it was?
No.
Was deducted from the purchase price?
It was essentially deducted from the purchase price.
For his half of the accounts payable.
No,
all the accounts payable.
Right. No, all the accounts payable. This transaction would take place just as if another person, as Ralph said, if one of you bought the property. That's the only way to handle it.
So the 90, sorry to interrupt, but the 92 was before the real estate or anything. That might have been
bills
or anything like that.
And I know Sean has been involved in many transactions where you buy a business. You buy, you're not going to buy the person's debt. You expect with the proceeds that you pay the person, it's just part of any transaction. When you buy a business, the proceeds that you pay with is pays off his debt. You don't,
and that's what
unless
the
it's specifically agreed to, you're not going to inherit his debt and pay his debt of a business you're buying.
Okay.
That money that was distributed wasn't a distribution. It was to pay off the outstanding payables of the corporation that Ralph bought.
And that came from Ralph and Sandy.
No, it didn't come from Ralph and Sandy. It came from the proceeds of the sale.
All right, okay.
He was the seller. In other words, he was the seller. He took all that money in.
Yes,
you were. He paid off the debts to the business, and then he distributed the money to each of the heirs.
All right.
Mr. Leonard's client received a little over $171,000. Ralph and Sandra were allowed $171,000 towards the purchase price.
All right.
We could have taken all of it and then distributed it.
Right.
The bank wanted to do it by means of a credit.
Okay. Got it.
All right, so let me just go through this, all right? You've been appointed special administrator, which I see.
Well, that's actually, that appointment is a permanent administrator.
What's that?
That appointment that you have.
It's permanent. It's the permanent. In essence, the court ordered that the that the restaurant, in this case, the be sold. It was put up for sale. That's the license to sell, which we have here.
Yeah.
It was put up to sell for sale. Mr. Constantine and his sister ended up buying it from the estate,
yeah.
in which we have the purchase and sale agreement.
And
what's that?
No, we That's, do have the agreement here.
Yeah, and I've got the agreement, so that was agreed upon. A disbursement was made for one of the checks to, I assume it must have been...
Linda Scotland.
Okay, fair enough.
Mm-hmm.
And now the only issue that really is in contention here amongst the two parties, in essence, is $92,000 was deducted because it was said that that went with, it's obviously it's not agreed here, but $92,000 in debt stays with Pebble, I assume Pebble Beach or whatever the estate, and you're saying it doesn't, and you're saying, that, no, I'm not going to get into who it is.
The court said that it wasn't, so that's the final say.
The court approved the purchase and sale agreement.
But they approved
the
sale of
this. Actually, I think you have my copy, but in any case, if you look at the purchase and sale agreement, clause L requires a seller to pay all liens, encumbrances, absolute, accrued, contingent, or otherwise, whether due or to become payable from the proceeds of the closing, either before or at the time of the closing. We chose to do it after the closing, outside the closing.
Okay. All right, so does everybody understand what's...
Yeah, I do. Okay. Was the debt a note, or was the debt just vendors?
It was vendors, it was, licensing fees, it was dozens of things. Right.
But those assets were included in the purchase price?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Can I ask a question for you?
One last question. And you, as a trustee, paid those debts with the 92?
Well, I could have paid them and written a bunch of checks. I made the adjustment to the closing, and Ralph took care of the payment.
But
took the responsibility for the payment. An adjustment was made for these accounts that were due.
So Ralph got the $92,000 and the debt to pay the bills.
Exactly.
Pretty much. Okay.
Is that in the P&S?
Yeah.
So it says somewhere in there
section
that...
Section 11. Well... Section L, I'm sorry.
Yeah, but it's...
Read it closely before...
Seller warrants...
It doesn't say anything about being around... As I understand it, Ralph didn't come to the passing of $225,000, and then he didn't turn over $225,000 to Mr. Albanese. And Mr. Albanese didn't write checks to pay off the payables out of that $225,000. He gave Ralph a credit. He gave Ralph a credit of $92,000. That's a credit he gave Ralph. And Ralph could do with it as he pleased.
That's right.
So, well, okay.
Yeah.
So that's a credit.
He's making
that
argument
that's
for
a,
us.
Please. That's a credit to two of the heirs. Linda should get a reciprocal credit.
No.
In other words, Mr. Albanese reduced the price. The price, if you will.
But is Linda going to pay half of the debt?
Hang on.
No,
isn't, excuse me. I'm just,
well,
we're
John,
getting
I,
into,
yeah,
we're getting into, hold on, okay? I'm the chair. Well, it means I have the gavel. We're getting into really legal arguments here, and it's not the purview of my board, our board, to be getting into this sorted affair. And we're not going to go there. The issue, we're not going to go there. I mean, it basically, you two sides have a beef. Mm-hmm. And the forum is the court,
exactly.
And that's not here.
So is that an accurate statement? A liquor license cannot be transferred until all outstanding debts of the present holder have been satisfied?
I don't know. And
that's
so this is what I'm going to suggest right now.
If he
owed taxes. Hold on, Mr. Albanese. There is a question that's raised that a liquor license cannot be transferred unless all the debts of the estate have been paid. So
the debts is Linda, so
what I would propose is I'd like to get clarification on that, and I'd like to see, you know, since this is from Mr. Leonard, then if you could give us something, and, you know, I'd like to probably say, let's continue this to our next meeting to get it resolved. But until then, I'm not satisfied unless I know that's true. That's what my suggestion is.
I would say we go to our town council. Get them to clarify. I've never heard of this, that we couldn't transfer a license.
I haven't either.
I can clarify that for you if you want me to. If there are outstanding bills to the liquor vendors, or if there are outstanding bills, municipal bills to the town, you can prevent it. A private conflict about what's due and what's owable does not prevent the transference of a license. And that's unequivocal.
I think that's true.
I was not at the passing. I was not present there. I don't know what constitutes as 92,000. Through you, could that you?
I can't do that. No, I'm not. All I'm looking for, I can't. Okay.
I want to see what those $92,000 is.
But Mr. Leonard, I can't.
Point of order. The issue before the board is the transfer of license.
And he's trying to bring all these other issues into it.
Folks, this is.
The chair has indicated to postpone it to another meeting. I suggest, John, the 21st, because your next meeting is.
It's loaded. So it's going to be the 21st. Now, here's what I'm going to suggest, okay? If both of you would like to put a memo, a brief two-page memo together and get it to us in 2 weeks prior to our, because I don't want to be given anything at our hearing, because I will not hear anything. I guarantee you, if somebody, not that Mr. Leonard, I'm not saying it's helpful, but I'm going to postpone it again. I want it so we can see it. And in the meantime, I'll also get clarification for our vantage point, but I'd like to see the legality and this, what you're stating and what, and backing it up by the statute. So that's what I propose.
Can I just give you a little background of what his forum should be?
You know what? No. No.
Yeah,
you can do it by you can do it and vice versa. Okay. So that's how I'm looking at it.
The forum, because you're at the wrong forum.
This is an issue for the.
All right, gentlemen, please, with all due respect,
always,
thank you.
I'm going to continue it. Okay. So all right. Enough said. Moving on, if somebody could ask Mr. Norton to come in, Mr. Bangert, or Mr. Norton, if you don't mind. We're moving on to agenda item number 9, a discussion award of contract. What's that?
Good evening.
Fair enough, Al. We're talking about Galen Damon Pond Reservoir.
Good, I guess.
All right?
Yes.
All right. I'll tell you what, let's
take 2 minutes?
A 2 minute break, if you don't mind.
White
all right?
Guy.
Thanks.
White haired guy. What are we doing? Taking a break?
Take a break. ladies and gentlemen, I just wanted to at least give a kind of an update. There was an individual who needed a medical emergency, and I'm at least my thoughts, I think all our thoughts and prayers should go out to the individual and the person's family. We know that the person has been transported to the hospital, and we hope that things are fine. But I wanted to at least give an update, because obviously it happened earlier in our meeting, and you know, people at home were watching it, as well as the people here were witness to it. So at least it's all I know, and that's just wanted to at least let you know that. So I would like to move on, though, to the next agenda item, which is a discussion award the contract for Galen Pond Reservoir. And Mr. Bangert, you're the individual who's asked this exactly. Could you please just briefly explain what you're looking for?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm here to request your agreement to engage an engineering firm to determine the feasibility and the cost of restoring Galen Damon Pond as an active reservoir in our surface water supply system. The town's surface water supplies, just a moment of background, is a system of series of streams, brooks, and ponds that collect water from First Heron Brook watershed and direct it to the old Oaken Bucket Pond next to the treatment plant on 3A. Our watershed winds through Cohasset, Norwell, and Scituate, as you can see from the map before you and from this map over here in the wall. Our watershed starts up here in Cohasset, works through Norwell, works its way through Scituate, primarily on land controlled by conservation or town resources, ends up in Tack Factory Pond, the reservoir, and then heads down to Old Oak and Bucket, where it then is treated or passes out to sea. The key point here is that during the rainy season, the water from the uplands flows unimpeded through our reservoirs and runs out into the sea where it's lost. What we'd like to do, the Water Department and the Water Resources Committee together have investigated this, and we would like to examine the opportunity to restore this pond that's upstream as an active reservoir in our supply system. The idea being that this mill pond, which was built in the 1800s and has fallen into disuse, would be able to retain the rainy season water for then release during the drier seasons for use in our water treatment plant. Restoring the pond would enable us to do this, saving the winter and spring water for use during the summer. The pond was actually served as a dam supplying a lumber mill operation in the 1800s. It retained its capability as a dam and a pond. There was a Boy Scout camp there for many years, but over time the spillway in the dam has fallen into disuse and has been left open. We propose to engage an engineering firm, STV, who has extensive experience in restoring and repairing these sorts of reservoirs. We've asked them to provide us with a proposal in two phases. The first phase will be to do the wetlands delineation, do the topographic survey, do the necessary permitting and core drilling, and then provide us with a full analysis of the cost and benefit of restoring this reservoir. How much water would we have, how much would it retain, and what would be the cost to redevelopment. That engineering study would be $48,000. If at that point, we would come back to you and say, here's the cost and benefit of this kind of restoration, and then we would be able to proceed further if we advised you that way and if you then so chose to do so. So what we're asking at this point is to enable us to find out what using this reservoir would cost and what it would do for us in terms of a benefit for providing some summer water. So we request that funding be authorized for this first phase only. That would be the funding would come from the MBTA mitigation funds that were previously used to restore other water resource opportunities. If after this it's clear that we have benefit, we'll come back to you.
Questions from the board?
Just for the engineering.
Mr. Vignani?
One quick question. Great document, by the way, Al.
Okay.
I mean, these are such good summaries. We really come in informed. Phase two, the $38,000, does that actually do work, or is that still just engineering?
No, that is, that is to do work and include construction oversight. So what has to happen if we went to phase two, we would do the final engineering, which means the preliminary engineering establishes what is the dam made of, what we need to do with it. Then they would have to come up with the exact specifications, including clearing of the pond, perhaps dredging of it, building the height of the reservoir dam up. The permitting with the Department of Dam Safety as well as conservation, managing the bidding process, and then managing the construction oversight. At this point, I can't tell you what would be the cost to restore this dam. That's why we want to go forward with step one.
Right. So, Mike, the reason I ask is I'm trying to figure out what the scope of the whole, if it turns out to be a beneficial thing to do, are we talking, you know, $1 million project?
No, we're probably talking $400,000 to maybe $500,000 in total, including these monies.
I need to just stop you there. The lady with the computer, I noticed you just put, is this a transcribing machine or something, or is it
audio?
Who are you with? You have to identify. Okay. No, I at the start of the meeting, I have to
she
ask that.
She raised her hand, John. You didn't.
Oh, I didn't say. I apologize. Fair enough. Good. Just so everybody understands. All right. Next question, Mr. Harris. Sure. I said you wanted.
No, Tony, you're done.
Just to finish it. What? And we talked about this a little bit. What resources would you expect to use to fund a $400,000 or $500,000 project? Just so everybody knows what's available out there.
I think good option would be to use the MBTA Open Space Water Resource Funds that were established during the negotiations with the MBTA back in 2000. There's some money remaining in that. The other source would be to then fund it from the water department.
Or you could use CPC money?
I'm not sure. Perhaps CPC money, but I haven't explored that option. But there are some numerous options to explore.
But it could also be funded within the enterprise fund itself.
Yes.
Great. Motion.
Mr. Harris?
How do you access this? Al?
Yes. If you go out First Parish Road,
right,
go past the Norwell line,
mm-hmm,
and begin looking for... Do you know where Betty from Flower and Festivities lives?
Yes.
No.
No, okay, well...
No, but beyond Laurelwood Drive? So we're in Norwell.
You go beyond Laurelwood Drive.
Okay.
Past the entrance to Laurelwood Drive.
Right.
Past two nice resident driveways.
Okay.
Then there's an access road into what's a large quantity of water, of Scituate Water Department land that we've always owned.
All right.
And that pond is located on this land we own.
So the pond is all in on Scituate property?
Yes, the pond and everything that we would develop is on Scituate property.
And I think you said it earlier, but it just came to me afterwards. It doesn't currently feed anything in Cohasset. So if we start drawing this, we're not going to have, or another town's not going to have a negative effect that we're going to start.
Exactly.
So that's the case. It's
right. This is not actually what this is. You think of it this way. This is not new water. This water is already passing by our pond. Well, unfortunately, it passes right on by and goes out to sea where we lose it. So what we want to do is
regulate.
Keep some of that for later use. It's a storage reservoir rather than tapping someone else's water.
Okay.
So do you want a motion?
Please.
Okay. Now, in this motion, do we have to say where we're getting the funds from, Tricia?
I would suggest that.
So why don't we discuss that for a second? The options would be the mitigation money or from the retained earnings, I guess, in the water department.
I would
say the mitigation.
I say the mitigation money.
At least this first phase, and if it gets
beyond that, then.
So, yeah.
Okay.
So I'll make a motion, move the Board of Selectmen vote to award the contract for preliminary engineering and analysis to STV Engineering of Boston for an amount not to exceed $48,000 to be taken from the MBTA mitigation fund.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Norton. Discussion? Any questions from the audience? All right, seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Just ask Al one other question while you have this map out, if you still, or you don't even need it. Didn't the town some years ago, a long time ago, buy property for water purposes between Maple and Old Oak and Bucket?
Between where?
The corner of Old Oak and Bucket and Maple, somewhere where that stream or brook runs now for water purposes. I've had people tell me in town.
It could be. I'm not sure. My memory doesn't go back to that.
I saw it on the map.
Yeah, that's all right. I can't tell you for sure when we bought this property. It may have been back with the original purchase of the private water company.
All right.
Because at that time, that would have, well, in that same time frame, it would have still been South Scituate, I believe. I'm not sure.
Still is. Thank you, Al. All right, moving on to the next discussion vote, streetlights. Mr. Bangert.
This one is a little less glamorous, but I'm requesting permission to turn off several streetlights in North Scituate, Greenbush, and on Peggity Beach Road. The background of this is that the Board of Selectmen have a policy that the adding or removing of streetlights on public streets should be approved by the board. That was a policy you adopted in September of 07. I'm here tonight to make several requests. Okay, the first one, straightforward, in North Scituate, when we installed the MBTA-funded streetscapes project, we installed 32 additional streetlights, 32 additional decorative streetlights. What I'm requesting is that we officially turn off the 8 now redundant old-style streetlights that remain in that area, salamander-type streetlights are called, and because the new lights provide sufficient illumination to meet public safety needs, we'll save around $1,500 per year, and the area will look more attractive. The second is the same project in Greenbush, where we installed 31 streetlights. We're looking to turn off 6 redundant streetlights, and that will save $500 or $600 per year. And thirdly, on Peggity Beach Road, the residents at number 25 through 35 Peggity Beach Road have petitioned to have the streetlight in front of number 31 Peggity Beach Road extinguished. Safety Officer Thompson and I reviewed the request, and we both conclude that the removal of this light will not cause a public safety issue. So we would advise that, if you so choose, that would be an acceptable thing to do. The town administrator agrees with these changes, and we're asking if we may go ahead and ask National Grid to remove these lights from service.
Motion?
Questions at all, otherwise? No?
Sure.
What is a salamander style? Is that just the one that has the little...
The kind that has a big head that sticks out like this off a pole. They're usually kind of pink-looking lights, sodium lights. You know, the standard today's modern kind of street lights that are up near the top of the pole.
Move the Board of Selectmen authorize the Department of Public Works to direct National Grid to extinguish 14 street lights in Greenbush and North Scituate, as detailed by the DPW director.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Any questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you, Al.
One more?
One more.
Oh, yeah.
Move the Board of Selectmen authorize Department of Public Works to direct National Grid to extinguish one streetlight in front of 31 Peggity Beach Road.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Discussion? Seeing none. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous. That's quick. Thank you, Al. All right. Moving on to agenda item number 11. Discussion, an award contract, Salt Breen. Mr. Cafferty.
Salt brine mixture, actually. We've explored different options on fighting snow this year. One of the options, we looked at it and came up at town meeting. The voters vote to allow money for a salt brine system. What this does, it allows us to add pure salt to a water solution, and it mixes it, similar to like the calcium chloride, but we can apply a direct brine solution to the roads as a pretreatment before the snow and during the snow. And it's a savings on salt, and hopefully it helps out with our snow fighting abilities.
How does that happen if you put it before it snows and then snow comes and then they plow? And
what happens is it increases the pH of the road so that when the snow hits it, the salt is already in there, so it causes it to turn to a liquid form and run off the road instead of staying on the roadway.
Okay.
And the idea is we would have one large truck with a 925-gallon tank on it, and, you know, like, we know a hurricane's coming up now. If it was a snowstorm, we could start pre-treating 2 days in advance, hopefully saving overtime. The word I've heard is you can put it up to 3 days in advance, and you will have some sort of effect on the brine solution, increasing the pH of the roadway. That'll help out.
Do we have a truck that can do that, or do we have to buy one?
We will.
All right. Okay.
Yes, we do. We
you're going to have to buy one,
when
right?
When we talked about this, didn't Lexington, and didn't you look at two or three towns
Lexington,
that did this successfully?
I brought Mike Breen up to take a look at Lexington system. I had researched it in Lexington, and we had got it. And it's actually just get put into position. They didn't have it all together in time for last winter. We put it out to bid. We were able to save a lot of money on the bid prices that we got originally. We heard costs of up to $120,000 for the whole system. By putting it out to bid, we came back. It's... $89,985 we were able to get it for with the tank and the whole salt brine system on it. So we did pretty good in that aspect. And also Bedford uses it, and a couple other towns, Maine and New Hampshire, also use a similar system. So
it's supposed to pay for itself in two 2 years?
If I talk to the salesman, it'd be the first year, but I mean, more realistically, you know, your big savings is on, there's two applications, not to get into the little nitty-gritty details, but as the salt comes out of the truck, it pre-wets the salt, so the salt sticks to the ground, so it's a salt saving, so it's kind of hard to tell, depending on how much snow and ice you have over the course of the winter.
Motion?
Please. Any questions at all?
So is it, they're going to be saddle tanks, or are you going to have a tank truck?
We are going to have a couple saddle tanks, and we are also going to have a 925-gallon tank on the back of one of the trucks.
That's right.
And it's a pretty slick setup they have. You just back up to it, and it comes off, and the legs fold out automatically, so you can put a sander or something else into it right afterwards. And it's a nice little system.
Good.
Do we know the name of the company?
The company is Howard P. Fairfield, LLC. I given Kim an updated sheet. I apologize about that. I thought you guys had it.
Howard, I probably
Howard
missed it.
P. Fairfield, LLC.
Okay.
Yeah, we have
and
it.
And the price was $89,985.
Great.
And it's a Cargill system.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to award the contract for salt brine system to Howard P. Fairfield, LLC of Pembroke, New Hampshire, for an amount not to exceed $89,985.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Norton. Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Unanimous. Thank you, Kevin. Moving on to discussion item, or agenda item, I keep saying discussion item. Agenda item 12, a discussion vote on the cable television expenditures. Tricia.
Yeah, I'd like to ask Mary and Rich Long to come up as well, since they're the architects of some of this. I'm just a cutter and recommender. And by way of explanation, the board has a rather detailed memo as to how the budget appropriations for the remainder of this fiscal year need to be appropriated. Both Rich and Mary and I met each with a list of their needs and how we can accommodate some of them within the confines of the cable contract, which changes somewhat after January 1. This does not reflect all of their requests. To some extent, it's less than Rich requested, and I added some more on the town side than Mary requested, with the advent of our IT person hopefully coming on in April with no budget. So and Rich and Mary can ask specific questions about items or whatever. There's plenty of money. Mary did I think I gave you a synopsis of the fund balance relative to the expenditures.
Can you go over I couldn't quite understand that last page. What is the balance that's in there now?
Yeah, I'm not sure which one you have. But the balance right now, I haven't had any receipts booked yet for August, which I think we would be due for a payment. But right now, the balance was $372,000. And we estimate the FY11 revenue about $298,000 that we'll be getting in this fiscal year.
298 more?
Yeah. Based on FY10's revenue.
So $670,000. And that will come in before the end of this fiscal year?
Yes.
And all of these expenditures total of $244,000, is that?
Yeah. My math is right.
$246,000.
$246,000. You were out. I had to do it myself.
$246,579. I checked it. I bet you were.
$246,579. I was off by $2,000.
And you spoke with Bill August, and he said that after this fiscal year, that we're going to have to track that revenue better and associate the cost more to cable.
So we're doing really technology things now, and that's why we're held off the PC till January, because those have video streaming. We can watch cable downloaded from the computer, so that's an allocable expense. And I know that for sure, so I checked that. So that's why we're front-loading the technology now.
But if we're only spending $240,000 of the $670,000, and we kind of have a little bit of a window here to purchase outside of the cable realm. Is that accurate?
Through December 31st, you could do just technology-based stunt.
So why aren't we spending more?
Well, because it rolls over and we'll have continuing cable needs for PC acquisitions and things like that. They'll still be technology-based. It's just we
right.
need to
you could link
increase
it.
Our general fund support for all of these items in FY 12. That's going to be the real thing that we talked about. We'll still be able to do most of the expenditures from the school are PC-based because they're buying 100, 200 at a point, but we're going to have to fund in FY 12 technology-based things, and we're working toward that with the technology budget already. But I understand your point. I don't know what else, and we can look at that beyond these items if you want, what else we could do between now and December 31st that's strictly technology.
Right. I mean, it seems like we just have a small window here where we can use the money for a little bit more liberal.
Other questions from the board?
Motion.
I had one more question before.
Sure.
Before in your note here, when we discussed setting up the cable committee, it says in fiscal year 12, it will be a budget item, will not require approval of the board. There were two avenues that we could go through to allocate that money, like an independent board or just keep it with the selectmen. How does that fit into this?
You'll have two things now. I mean, you have an IT budget that's going to have some of these budgeted expenses you're approving now, and that's approved by town meeting. And now you have a cable budget that you established at town meeting. So what will happen is during the regular budget review, when you come in to review the cable budget, that's when you'll be approving everything. So it will be done at the annual town meeting and won't come in several times during the year, unless the cable committee comes to you and recommends, you know, something else. So they're still reviewing the expenditures and recommending to you.
Right, but the board here is, or the whatever the current board of selectmen are, still have control over the use of that money.
Yes.
Now, previously it didn't have to go through the budget process, though.
That's right, but now that under the contract where you have a cable studio that's soon to be in operation, you need to have a budget to appropriate out of that. Otherwise, we're coming to you every month to do the regular expenditures. So we already created that budget, and it's in this budget already. It just has
right.
no money in it.
No, I understand that. I guess the allocation process, it's still, the spending of these funds, is we're still the board that
yes.
kind of mandates that.
You're just going to do it during the budget process,
right.
90% of it.
Right.
And then if something else comes through the year
it
that
still
you
has
want
to come before us.
Access, cable
right.
has to still come to you.
And the other option for us was to create a separate board, and they would be the...
Because they're here for the technology piece in support
mm-hmm.
of town and school. Then there's a whole other cable piece that's buying equipment
mm-hmm.
for the studio that we need to migrate the peg to.
Right.
And then increase the general fund support of the technology-based stuff.
Right. And that's what that other 400 will
yeah.
be.
Rick? Motion.
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote cable television expenditures in the amount of $246,579 for the town and school for calendar years 2011-2012 per the recommendations of the town administrator, town accountant, and the school's IT director.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Unanimous. Thank you. Thank you, Richard. All right.
You're good to go.
We'll move on to agenda item number 13, a discussion vote, sergeant promotion process. And on behalf of the applicant,
you have this.
Town administrator.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Tricia, you're up again.
Yes.
Sergeant. On the promotion of a sergeant.
I just wanted to go over
process.
The board. I provided a memo.
Number one.
We have a vacancy for sergeant in the police department. And what this memo that I provided to you outlines the process that I will employ in making the appointment. I wanted to bring it to your attention as well as I have notified the chief and the union of how it would probably be different than in past years. And I'm happy to address any questions relative to that, but that will be taking place next month.
Good.
And right. then obviously my recommended appointment will go to you and the board can accept it or rescind it within 15 days.
Questions from the board?
I think this is, John just pointed out, and if I can, that this is the first time that we've been, we'll see such an extensive process in making an appointment for it, and that's good. I'm not, it's, I think it's going to end up with a better selection and process as we go forward.
And it's very documented. There's very clear where this goes to there, to there, to there.
And this will be, you know, this probably won't change much when you do promotions for lieutenant or captain of fire or whatever. It allows people to know what the review criteria are in the selection process and what the expectations are going forward for command staff positions in the public safety.
Mm-hmm. Do we need them?
Nope.
It's just an informal.
All right.
You want a you don't need a motion for this, I was going to say. All right, so good. That's agenda item number 13. Moving on to 14, a discussion of the 2010 fall special town meeting date. And basically, this is for us. Thank you.
The memo that you have in your packet, you need to include our.
Okay.
Gave you, which I wrote on the 20th, 21st, indicated that town business requires that we need to balance our FY11 budget again, and we have some other time-sensitive items, and it recommended a date of November 1st. However, I had heard from everybody on that except the town clerk, who, when I returned from vacation, reminded me that we have an election November 2nd, and the gym is set up for an election. So what I did is this calendar of October and November to sort of walk you through the difficulties we've had in trying to set this town meeting. Even the November 8th date is not ideal and actually creates quite a few additional hardships and challenges for the town clerk's office because she has to certify the voting list after the election on November 2nd and have it ready for voters to check in the following Monday. But I spoke with Bernice at length, and she understands the challenge, and we're going to try to provide some resources to her to help her staff that week after the election really concentrate on getting the election list up to date. Her office will be closed to the public probably the rest of that week. Which is an inconvenience to residents, but is necessary given the difficulties. The town bylaws require that we have town meeting on a Monday. October 4th is way too soon because essentially you'd be all done in a week given the posting lead requirements we have to put it in the newspaper. Then we have Columbus Day. I'm out of the office on the 18th at a long-standing commitment. The moderator is not available on the 25th because he's doing another special town meeting in the town. He serves as town council. As I mentioned already, November 1st is the day before election day, so we're now looking at November 8th. The window we have has to be within here because you have to have the tax classification hearing between, you know, mid-November in order to assure that the tax rate is certified, which allows us to generate the tax bills, which means they get out by December 31st. I'm very obsessive about that calendar being held because you go in a queue at DOR anyway, and so the later we do a town meeting, the smaller the window is, and we don't want to be in position of sending our tax bills out. So I met with the assessor. We're all on track to do this. Typically, you have your hearing around the 15th anyway. So what I'm asking the board right now is to set the proposed town meeting date for November 8th and to consider doing that and that to formally vote it at your next meeting on Tuesday because I still have to check with the moderator and to set dates for opening and closing the warrant on the September 7th meeting. I would also like to suggest to the board that we have a warrant article that changes the bylaw requiring us to have a Monday-only special town meeting. Because as you can see, we're always going to have some elections in the fall. There's always going to be Columbus Day. My language will probably say, and we can get into it later, we'll be on the Monday unless the selectmen determine otherwise, that the town business needs to be accommodated otherwise, so, or something. Because as you can see, this is really pretty tight to do.
That makes sense.
So you said the warrant is going to open and close on?
7th?
The 21st would be my, you will
set the 21st of September.
You will vote to set the town meeting date on the 7th.
Mm-hmm.
And then because, again, of these publication deadlines and enough lead time for advisory, obviously, and to get the requests in the 21st, which is still going to be a little tight to have necessary discussion because I'm looking at, you know, between 6 and 12 warrant articles that the board needs to decide if they want to go forward. We have deadlines we're coming up against if the board wants to move forward on anything relative to solar on the landfill. The Green Communities Initiative in terms of things we hoops we have to jump through to access millions of dollars in energy grants needs to be done this fall. 41 towns just adopted it at their annual town meeting, so we need to decide whether we're going to go forward or not and if town meeting votes it up and down. So there's some unusual things for a fall town meeting, but obviously what's driving it is the fact that our budget is out of balance. Our local receipts through June 30th are a little less than projected. It's not fatal. As you know, we got an additional cut in local aid that we have to cover a little delta for. And there's some other items in terms of taking the MBTA money and actually establishing a Pier 44 budget, because right now we're fronting the cost for the alarm system and things like that. So some housekeeping things.
Okay. So based on your scheduling, it looks like we'll be having a special town meeting on Monday, November 8th.
As of today, before.
Opening the warrant on the 7th, which will be next Tuesday, closing it on the 21st. Is that
right? If the board so votes to set the day. And I also anticipate some additional petition articles for this meeting as well, so therefore it's important that we get proper notice out.
Mm-hmm. Discussion from the board?
No.
All right. You don't need a vote.
No, we just, that's I want what to it do is. That next
okay.
Tuesday.
So we'll do it next Tuesday. Fair enough. All right. Let's moving on to the next agenda item, number 14A, a vote setting, set the poll hours for the state primary, which is on September 14th.
Motion, Mr. Chairman?
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to set the polling hours for the Tuesday, September 14th, 2010 state primary elections from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m.
Seconded by Mr. Harris. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. Moving on to agenda item number 15, discussion vote. Mass General Laws, Chapter 138, Section 33B, change in liquor license serving hours. I will say this. I did receive a phone call from, I guess, the applicant. I didn't realize. I thought this was going to be the, actually it was the Levers. This I thought was going to be a general discussion. But I see that they were requesting it specifically, and they are not here. I'd ask that we postpone this to another meeting then. Because I told them, I thought it was going to be a general discussion on whether or not we pull it back.
I think it is.
Okay.
They were the ones that brought it forward to ask whether the board would consider voting this.
Right.
But I didn't think it was necessary. I mean, I did notify them of tonight's meeting,
right.
But I didn't think it was necessary that they be here.
Okay.
To speak.
All right. The reason why I say that is because seeing that it's an applicant that I've represented, and I'm going to recuse myself on this discussion. I'll let the three
this
of you discuss
be,
it.
If the board votes to do this, it's for all licensees.
All licensees.
Right.
But I'm going to recuse nonetheless because it's the applicant who is or was a client. So for purposes, that's what I'm going to do. So I'll let you folks discuss it, and then I'll come back.
I could just start. this is... I've given a lot of thought to this, and it's what we have to do first is accept the change in the law, the change being that would allow us to allow restaurants to serve liquor at 10 o'clock in the morning on Sundays, something with no city or towns have been allowed to do. And the argument that people come forward with it's a fine one. It's you know that there are brunches served in certain restaurants throughout the Commonwealth, and particularly in Scituate, that would like to be able to serve a one or two type drinks, a Bloody Mary or something else, to their patrons during that brunch, which on the surface seems not a big problem. However, it's my understanding that you just cannot single out particular restaurants that have brunches and say, okay, we'll give it to this one, we'll give it to that one. You have to accept the law in its entirety, and then you can deal with it on an individual basis. So I guess what I'm getting at is, you give it to one restaurant, it's very difficult to give it to another. You give it to one restaurant who serves a brunch and who can certainly use it probably. I question how many, it's not a big deal. I think the cost of opening up 2 hours early and waiters and bartenders and everything else to serve a couple of Bloody Marys may, but that's not my decision. But you're also going to be faced with other non-brunch restaurants, if I can put it that way, and clubs and posts, whatever it might be, will also probably come forward and request a 10 o'clock Sunday morning liquor license. We try very hard over the years to curtail the hours of operation whenever possible, cutting back from 1 o'clock in the morning to midnight to 11 o'clock, if we can do that. And here we are on the other end, extending it 2 hours. I know, understand that 1 o'clock in the morning is different than 10 o'clock Sunday morning, but we still are extending the hours. So it's not as open and shut to me as it might appear. And I realize that it may be a generational thing here, and I fully understand that, but I think we have to give some thought to extending liquor hours in town under any circumstances. Not to, and again, I repeat that there are very good restaurants that we try to help in every way we can. But I've seen in the past where restaurants open, and I'll finish with this, when they come looking for a new liquor license and they're going to serve, you know, homemade beef stew and clam chowder and stuff like that, and then when they open up, they're selling 24, you know, ounces of pitchers of beer, and there's no clam chowder, and there's no hot apple pie that mother makes. It's so sometimes what starts out as a good idea and you think you're doing the right thing ends up not the way you anticipated it. Not that this would happen in this situation, but again, we're not, if we do this, we're not limiting it to a couple of drinks that are you know, served during the brunches. We're opening it up to serving anything at all, anything and everything, at 10 o'clock in the morning, and I'm wrestling with it. With that, thank you.
I have a quick question. Did we pass the law 33B that extended it to 11? Are we, what is our?
Yes, I think so. I think that
so passed. Years ago, it went from 12 to 11, and we accepted that?
I believe so.
Okay. And then, as Joe just said, I think this gives us the ability to extend someone's license on a Sunday. It doesn't grant anyone the right to do that. They still have to come before us one at a time, and we set the hours as the licensing board as we feel is necessary. The big question is, if we didn't do it the first time, then we have to kind of do the first step of the law before we do the second one.
I don't remember doing it either, but maybe when we renewed them, maybe we allowed establishments to pour at 11 a.m. Can I jump in, Joe?
Having said what
Tony just said, I was going to. So if Tony said is correct, and each establishment comes in for the right to pour earlier, we could say no. And then it could get overturned. I mean, I like the idea of trying to help out. I would like to have it just for innkeepers' licenses. It kind of makes sense, you know, for places like the Clippership, the inn. That may be the only one. It kind of makes sense. Does it make sense for the others? I can't really see it. I agree with you.
But it's difficult.
So can we, so what you're saying is we can't say yes to someone with an
it's
end.
It's difficult to say yes right. to one person and that serves
no
rent
to someone else.
No to somebody else, that's all.
But you, we can.
We can.
We
yes,
can, but
we
I think,
can.
Joe,
yep.
we're
yep.
going to be starting yep. a precedent that yep. would come back and...
Have we heard of any other towns that have done it?
I think this is quite, the people are in the process of, the law was just passed on the state level of
July 1st.
So I think towns are in the process of doing it now and not doing it. And I think most towns will do it, but I just have these reservations and thoughts that I want to come forward with it. I'm not saying that I wouldn't vote against accepting the statute. Maybe I will, but I just want to explain that it's not the easiest decisions. I remember just a few years ago, there was a great amount of concern raised by some of the churches in town when softball went to Sunday mornings, you know, and now we're taking the next step, I guess, going beyond softball. And that's all I'm saying. It's
and you're, we're not, I'm sorry.
We're not going to vote it. No, it's just a discussion. There's nothing
well,
wrong with the vote.
They're looking for a motion.
Yep.
And, you know, I guess my thought would be is to, if you vote to accept it, then you just have to be hard on the back end and only give it to those people that have a compelling story that we deem warrant serving alcohol earlier in the morning. So, on that, any other, do you have any other thoughts, Sean, or?
The proponent that is requesting this is looking for New Year's?
But not tonight, though, I don't think.
Right. They'd still have to come before us and ask.
Right, right, right. So, that was my question. What's the harm in waiting a couple of weeks? I don't know, just to hear the public's reaction.
That may be a nice idea.
You know, I don't know.
I like that.
You know, I don't know. I mean, I you know.
And then Rick can come back
yep.
and we yep. can hear his 2 cents.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. If there's any reaction one way or the other, you know, I'd like to hear it. And I say it's not necessarily by saying it's a bad law at all. It's
right.
probably
I mean,
a good
I
law.
Remember the days of the brunch of Pear 44. I mean, if things were like that, that's acceptable, you know.
Yeah, yep. Yeah, we can do it. Can we?
So why don't we post, let's see what the feedback is for the next couple.
If there is.
Well,
why
yeah,
we put
yeah
it
if
on
there
the
is,
21st.
We'll decide.
Okay. Yeah.
Right.
Good. Thank you.
Good discussion.
All right, moving on to our next agenda item. Happens to be the vote to accept a gift to the town. Memorial bench that is to be placed at the Little's Walk Golf Course.
Motion?
Go ahead, Tony.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the kind gift of a granite memorial bench in memory of George O'Brien and Les Mayo to be placed at Widow's Walk Golf Course.
Second.
And just for, this is being made by the friends of George O'Brien and Les Mayo. Led by Peter Murphy and John Bonner.
Just in case you guys don't know them, a couple of obviously Scituate residents. Les Mayo was not a permanent fixture, but he went to Widow's Walk quite a bit. I think he was a member at Scituate for a long time. Probably know his brother, the old treasurer collector, Larry, and Mr. O'Brien. You know, he was spent many, many weekends out on the football field, umpire. That's all, in case you didn't know.
Marilyn's his wife.
That's correct.
Marilyn, Bob.
Thank you. Yep.
So, who was a former, who used to work here also in town and with the planning board. Great, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Unanimous. Moving on to agenda item 16A, a vote, the Zoning Board of Appeals disclosure statement. And
yep. Want a motion? Or
please.
Do we need to explain anything or no?
But, you know, I can explain it. Basically, the Zoning Board of Appeals Chairman, Mr. Peter Morin, is disclosing that, well, just something fell over back there. Everybody's fine. They have an upcoming zoning hearing on a, I believe it's an antenna, AT&T application for a cell tower, and he's just disclosing that, I guess, just basically...
He's done work in that
field. He's done work in that field, so...
Move the Board of Selectmen as the appointing officials and as required by Mass General Law Chapter 268A, Section 19, have reviewed the matter and the financial interest or any other conflict described in the disclosure and have determined that the interest is not so substantial as to be deemed likely to affect the integrity of the services which the municipality may accept from the employee, Peter Morn from the Zoning Board of Appeals.
Second by anybody?
Second.
By Mr. Harris, all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Good. Other business?
None.
Mr. Harris?
Just one thing. I wish Al was still here. It seems like the only time the roundabout gets cut is when we, you know, residents call us. I mean, this is getting old, you know? And a good friend of mine, Kevin Barbie, called me up, and I didn't know what to tell him. It's, you know, when he complains, it gets done. At what point? It's still MBTA, owned by the MBTA?
And they're still trying to work out an agreement with Kennedy's.
Oh, I thought the Kennedy's were all on board, ready to just take care of it, and they haven't handed it over.
The MBTA is kind of a bureaucracy, and nothing's been executed yet.
That makes sense.
So essentially, that's exactly what happens. Somebody calls and complains, and then they'll put it on their radar and get it cut.
It's a nuisance.
What can we tell residents?
I think we can,
you know?
Maybe contact Representative Cantwell or Senator Hedlund and ask them, because it's been over a year now.
Right. All right. I'm sure we all see it.
You know, how about if we send a letter from the board and saying just that to Cantwell and also to Senator Hedlund and say, you know, can they help facilitate this to get it done? So why don't we do that? To get the lawn, can you believe it? In order to mow a roundabout, we're going to have to go through this process because the state is not willing to work with us on this. That just amazes me, the waste of time to have the state do what they should be doing in the first place.
It's an embarrassment. It's, you know, it's the entrance to the town, one of the major entrances, that's all.
No, and you're absolutely right, because I've received an email last week, and I drive around it almost every day, and I see it, and I'm like, you got to be kidding me. It's a mess. And we have to go through this in order to get the state to transfer it over when we have a willing person who's willing to take care of it and to beautify it, and we can't do it. It's pathetic with having to deal with the state in this, but on my soapbox, I'll get off it.
Just two quick things for other business.
Please.
And you may want to pitch in on one. I just want to make everyone aware that there's been a committee put together that's really doing some advanced work on the budget for next year. It consists of a couple school committee people, a couple selectmen, John and myself, advisor people, Bob in the back, Tricia, and some others. So just to keep everyone just apprised of the fact that we are trying to stay as much in front of the ball and understanding what our future fiscal concerns are going to be. And as we get this information together, we'll be rolling out to the public so that everyone's aware of what, I mean, we've talked about our concerns for this fiscal year and what the next fiscal year is going to be bringing to us also. Unfortunately, it doesn't look any better than the past, so that's why we're really taking the proactive step to really getting everyone together at the table and discussing these issues well in advance of the current budget season. Anything to add to that? Or?
No.
Okay.
No,
and the last thing is just remember to vote. Oh, no, we have another meeting before that. September 14th is the primaries. So no matter who you vote for or what party you're in, go vote.
I quickly have three things. One is Scituate Beach Association's having their parade, Sand Hills. So if you haven't gone, go enjoy it. It's a great event. It's all for kids, and that's coming up on Sunday. The other thing I was going to say is I wanted to commend the Scituate Little League. They did a phenomenal job this year. The baseball teams performed very well. It was in the Mariner and in the past, and not just the teams that actually won. A lot of the teams had done very well, and the coaches were superb. So kudos to the Scituate Little League. They did very well. The third thing was, at least I want to raise, because I think maybe we should discuss it maybe at another future meeting, but we're talking about celebrating our 375th anniversary of the founding of this town next year. And so it's something that we should maybe think about having some form of celebration the way that they did for the 350th 25 years ago. So I just wanted to raise that with the board to maybe think about it. Maybe we should talk to South Scituate, otherwise known as Norwell, to see if they'd like to participate in their anniversary too. Because
I'd rather not think about it, considering I was on the 350th committee.
And
I just don't want to think that far back, but that's a little scary.
But just to keep that as something in the to think about, we should discuss in the future. So, anything else other than business?
Nope.
Good. Moving on to correspondence. I think we have two letters.
The first one is to Chief Stewart from Ann Burbine, the Heritage Days Committee. I cannot begin to thank you for the officers assigned this past weekend for Heritage Days. Officers Billing, Brigham, Bowman, Gilmartin, Harrison, Kirkbride, McCauley, O'Brien, as well as Sheriff's Deputy Sheehan were professional, exceedingly helpful, and a pleasure to work with. They represent the town of Scituate well. You should be truly proud of your officers. Thank you, Ann. And this is probably one of the few evenings that we don't see Ann over there knitting. So, and the second one is from Tracy Johnson, and this is to the Recreation Department and the Town Administrator. I guess I'll just read the whole thing. During the week of August 2nd to 6th, the Scituate Corps Foundation sponsored Maritime Adventures, a water sports program through Access Sports America. During that week, children with a wide range of disabilities learned how to sail, windsurf, Hawaiian oat rigging canoe, paddle surf, and many of these children had never seen land from the ocean view before. Needless to say, it was an experience of a lifetime for the kids, the parents, and all the staff involved. What continually amazes me is the collaborative effort we receive from the town to make programs like this transform an idea into reality. Jennifer Vitale, the Director of Recreation, and her staff have been an integral part of the Corps Foundation's success from the beginning, helping us coordinate programs for children with special needs year-round in sports and camps. We could not do that without them. This year, we were also very impressed and appreciative of the overwhelming support from the Harbor Master, Mark Patterson, who allowed Maritime Adventure to successfully operate each day of the week. His attention to the details requiring and organizing this program, his personal visibility all week, and the operational support were critical to the wonderful experience had by all. We'd also like to thank Joe Noble, who was our right-hand man all week, and Fran McMillan, who volunteered his time and boat to bring parents out to the harbor to watch the kids in action. Because of these individuals, like these working in this community, course has been able to accomplish so much over the past 4 years. Words cannot express our true appreciation. From Tracy Johnston, the president of Scituate Corps Foundation.
I did go out that day. It was absolutely fantastic. I mean, it was unbelievable. I was there for about an hour and a half. I didn't want to leave to see those kids on the sailboats.
Yeah.
It was wonderful.
They do good things. They really do. Of course, it's a great organization.
And the people, John and I met some of the people that were teaching the programs, and they were just so energetic, and we hope they continue to come back.
Moving on from correspondence to minutes.
Move the minutes of August 3rd, 2010.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Fignani. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous.
I abstain on that. I think I was out.
So it's 3-0. Moving on into agenda item number 20, it's meaning we're going to be going into executive session, and the reason is it's collective bargaining, and obviously related to unions. If we were to discuss it in an open forum, that would hinder our abilities. So therefore, going into executive session. Roll call.
Yes.
Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
Good night, folks. Thank you.